So, unfortunately, I had a visitor in my office this morning, and I didn't get the chance to work this, so we're really going to do it live. So, the last time we met, I had coded up the rotations. So those are these functions. Compute SG we did a long time ago, right? That's compute SG is a function that takes in the principal stresses and the angles alpha, beta, gamma, and returns the geographic stress. This is a function I wrote when we were doing faults way back, okay? So then we wrote this one that, or at least I showed it, that you know this is now our rotation matrix for the wellbore. So this one takes in the principal stresses, delta and phi, the wellbore angles, and the geographic angles, alpha, beta, and gamma. Okay, it calls compute SG to return a geographic stress and then performs the rotation into the well and gives you the wellbore. So this is the one we worked before. Additionally, then, now that we have a wellbore stress, we had this compute wellbore stresses, which this is essentially the translation from Cartesian coordinates into polar coordinates. And then we had two functions, compute min and max wellbore stress, you know, so the tangential stress is ST min and ST max. The other principal stress is sigma RR, which is delta P. The only difference between min and max is that minus sign right there. So in min, there's a minus sign, and max, there's a plus sign. Okay. So we want to evaluate the required unconfined compressive strength to create a plot like we did before. Okay. So what do we need? What do we need to do that? I mean, we're going to use the Moore Coulomb failure criteria, which is what? You know, what's the function for it? If you remember, there was something like sigma 1 is equal to C0 plus Q sigma 3, right? Where Q, or maybe I used N, but you know it's just a slope, right? It's a slope on the plot, sigma 1, sigma 3, right? Where this is C0. So then Q is related to the internal friction, which is the parameter that we usually see. It's like the square root of mu squared plus 1 plus mu. Right? No, sorry. The square root sign ends here. And then this whole thing is squared. So obviously we can solve this equation for C0. Okay. So to compute the required C0, we just need sigma 1 and sigma 3, where these are the effective principal stresses in the wellbore. Okay. Where are breakouts going to occur? If they're going to occur, where are they going to occur first? In a vertical well. In a vertical well. Okay. Not so easy to know in a deviated well. Right. So remember our wellbore stresses are functions of the angle around the wellbore. Right. So we actually have to compute, the stresses, the tangential stresses at every point around the wellbore and determine where they're a maximum, right? Where they're a maximum is where the breakouts are going to occur. Okay. Now, I say every point, right? Can we really, there's a continuum of, there's infinity points around there, right? When we do it in a computer, we're not going to literally compute every single point. We're going to compute, we're going to choose some around the wellbore and try to determine. All right. So, oops. Okay. So I'm going to create a new function. I'm going to call it evaluate C0. You guys probably can't see that, can you? Can you see that better? So I'm going to create a function that's going to return C0. It's called evaluate C0. It's going to take as arguments the principal stresses, the wellbore angles, the geographic angles. So the wellbore angles are delta and phi. The geographic angles are alpha, beta, and gamma. Those equations that convert from Cartesian to polar coordinates have Poisson ratio in them as a parameter. So we need to include that as an argument, nu. I'll call that nu. That's the Poisson ratio. Our failure model takes the internal friction, mu, as an argument, right? So I'll include that, and the pore pressure, and the mud weight, okay? So the first thing we're going to do is compute the Cartesian stress tensor in the wellbore coordinate frame. We already have a function for that, right? So that's compute SB. And since we've already defined it, MATLAB gives us this little helpful thing. We fill it out. So as arguments, we have wellbore angles and geographic angles. So those will just be passed through, right? We'll stick them in this function, and they'll be passed through to that function. Okay, so now we have the stress tensor in Cartesian coordinates in the wellbore. Okay, we can, we'll create a new variable, delta P, dP, delta P, which is the pore pressure minus the mud weight. And that allows us to then compute the effective stress. So the effective stress is SB minus, well, we don't need that, but the pore pressure times the identity matrix. So now we have the effective stress, right? And we'll go ahead and define Q in terms of, this is the Q that I wrote in that equation a second ago. The square root of mu squared plus 1 plus mu squared. Okay. Now, remember what I said. We need to compute. We need to evaluate the stress at an array of locations around the wellbore, because we don't know exactly where the breakouts are going to occur. In general, right? I mean, we could figure it out if you knew all the angles and stuff. But we're writing a code that we want to be very general, so that I can put in anything and it'll always do the right thing. Right? So what we're going to do is we're going to say for theta equal to 1 to 360. You could do it in every an increment of 1 degree or less if you want, but I think it's pretty good to just say it, you know. So I'm gonna say from 1 to 360 in steps of 5 degrees. And the reason I will say 0 is because 0 and 360 are the same point, right, around the wellbore. So from 1 to 360 in steps of 5. What does MATLAB do there? Because it's not evenly. Let me see. 1 to 360 in steps of 5. Yeah, that would work in this case, right? Well, but then I have a repeated value. 0 and 360 are the same point, right? We'll just do it this way. It'll be in increments of 1. The code will just take a second longer to run. All right, so we'll actually evaluate it at every single point around the wellbore. Okay, so for theta from 1 to 360, then we're going to say ST max is equal to compute max tangent stress, which takes in arguments SB effective, nu, theta, and DP. ST min is same thing, except this is min, right? And so then sigma 1 is equal to the maximum of ST max, ST min, and DP. And sigma 3 is the minimum, right? Everybody understand what I did there? So these are the two tangential stresses, right? Really, in this one I could leave out the S min, and in this one I could leave out the S max. But sigma 1 and sigma 3 are the maximum and minimum principal stresses. And there's a chance that the delta P could be the minimum, right? And so we need to include it, and we're just going to take, for, you know, sigma 1 is the greatest principal stress. Those are the three principal stresses. So we use this. Excuse me. We'll use this function to figure out which one's the maximum and this one the minimum. Right. So then C0 is equal to sigma 1 minus Q times sigma 3. All right, so that's our Moore-Coulomb failure model. And then we're going to end the for loop. Right. Okay. But this is a loop, right? So this is there's actually not going to be just one C0. It's going to be 360 of them, right? going to be 360 of them. But if you look at this plot, right, I mean, that each of these sort of pixels, if you will, represents one C0 value at that value of phi and delta. So which one of the 360, which one of the 360 is the correct one? Which one do I want to take? Right? Because what I mean, remember, try to think about what these plots represent, you know, the fact that they're, you know, plotting required zero, C0, these represent the lowest value of C0 in which no breakouts will occur. So what I want is the lowest value of C0 that I compute as I move along the wellbore. I need the lowest one, because anything that's greater than that, there'll be breakouts. Right? So I need the smallest value, okay? So how can I do that in a clever way? Anybody got any ideas? As I go through the loop, when the loop exits, I want to have captured the lowest value of C0 that was computed. Well, I want to write a code that's general enough that, and also SH max. I mean, it's not, you don't know exactly where the wellbore, because it's a function of the angle of orientation, but also the deviation. Yeah, I mean, there is a way to geometrically figure it out, but there's an easier way. I mean, we have a computer, and these aren't. I mean, if these simulations were taken 2 days to run, and you needed a way to speed them up, then it'd probably be worth the trouble to go through that. But this is going to take 3 seconds to run, and there's just an easier way. Okay, I don't want to store a vector, though. You're right. But storing a vector is slow and memory intensive. Right? So how about I do this? What if I set, I'm going to initialize C0 to be a big number. What's the biggest number MATLAB knows? How about the biggest real number the computer can store? Anybody know what that is? Turns out MATLAB has a function for it. It's called real max. So the biggest number the computer can store, my computer, is that number. So we'll initialize C0 to be that. Okay. And then every time through the loop, I'm going to compute the minimum of the value that C0 was previous to going through this loop and the new value, which is from the failure model. Right? So since this is the biggest number the computers can store, any functional evaluation is going to be less than that, right? So the first time I go through the loop, what's returned here is going to be what's there, okay? But then the next time through the loop, it may be this or it may be that. It may be what I previously computed, right? Because it's cyclical, it's periodic, right? So it's going to go down and up and down. So in this case, this allows me to just get the value I want after, you know, I have to compute all of them, but when I'm done, I'll have the minimum, and I don't have to store a vector. And I don't have to go through the geometry to figure out exactly where it's going to occur. So this will return one value of C0 that is a minimum. Okay. Okay. So that's my function to that's going to evaluate C0. Okay. So now with that, I can sort of make my plot. So I'm going to create another function to do that. I'll call it create lower hemi plot. All right, and it's going to take, so this is just a function, create lower hemi plot. It's going to take as arguments the stress, the geographic angles, what else? New, mu, pore pressure, mud weight. All right. So the reason it doesn't take the wellbore angles is because we're going to sweep through them to create, right? We're going to sweep through them in a loop to basically compute all of these pixels. And this is where not working it this morning is going to come back to haunt me, because I don't use MATLAB enough to know the most clever way to do this. So I'm just going to start hacking and see if I can get it done before the end of class. So we have two angles, phi and delta. We'll phi goes from 0 to 90, right? So 0 to 90, and we'll take 50 increments. And delta goes from 1 to 360, and we'll take 50 increments of that. So then I'm going to say 4i equals 1 to 50. 4j equals 1 to 50. I want to evaluate CO. And now my wellbore angles are going to come, right? They're going to be delta I phi j. Yeah. Oh, that's an O, not a zero. Oh, I see. How do you rename it? Good now? Good catch. I would have been stuck on that. So this is the part I'm not, I have to think about how to do, because what I want to store are the x and y locations along with, you know, I want to make a contour plot, right? So I need an x and a y and a z, right? This is z. So there's going to be 50 times 50 values here, okay? So that's definitely z. So x, and this is because, remember, our delta and phi are in polar coordinates, right? Or spherical coordinates, sort of. And so you know, I want to make a contour plot where I'm just looking at the top of this, right? So I need this sort of projection of where whatever the point is, I need it projected back up onto this plane. Right? And so I need this value here. That's sort of the R, right? That's sort of the R. And that right there is this angle right here is phi, right? And so this, the R is the sine of phi. Right? So it's the sine of phi. Sine phi I times the sine of delta I phi j. Y. So this is still the sine because it's still the radius. So right, x is r sine theta, y is sine is r cosine theta, and r is the sine of phi, right? So sine phi j cosine delta. So I'll just call this Z. And I could leave that like that. However, in MATLAB, you know, if you don't pre-allocate the arrays, then it's going to be much slower. So I can just speed it up a little bit by pre-allocating the arrays. So x is going to be 50 by 50. So that'll help the speed a little bit, right? So that should compute basically 50 times 50 points around, right? However, there is one caveat, is that these are going to be sort of radially distributed, and I want to make a contour plot. Well, contour in plot in MATLAB doesn't accept. I mean, it wants the data on a regular grid, right? I think some of you that come to my office, or maybe the last assignment, you face the same problem, right? And that, you know, so we're going to be computing values because we're sweeping angles in polar coordinates. The values we're computing are going to be on a Cartesian plane like this, right? But MATLAB doesn't want to plot that. It wants to plot on a regular grid. Like that. So we need to create that regular grid, the blue dots, and interpolate the black dots onto the blue dots. Right? And the functions that we use to do that are mesh grid and grid data. So, so then we're going to have, you know, we'll create the grid, call it XG. Well, let's see. The grid's going to go from -1 to 1, And we'll take 50 points also. And this will be same thing. Then we'll have XG, YG equals mesh grid. Right? And then we'll use something like ZG equals grid data. And that'll be X, Y, and Z interpolated onto XG, YG, right? And then contour ZG or XG, YG, ZG, okay? And then, okay, I don't have time to run it and debug it and everything, but that gives you an idea of how to do it. And then you just call this function, plug in your principal stress values, your geographic coordinates, and you should get a plot that looks something like this, right? So you'd have to plug in your geographic angles according to these, what you know, plug in these values, and you get a plot that looks something like that.